This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Aaron Maté. Our guests today are Greg Jaffe. He's with the Center for Science in the Public Interest, and Winona Howder of Food and Water Watch. Her book is called Foodopoly, The Battle Over the Future of Food and Farming in America. I want to read from Monsanto's statement regarding what they call the Farmer's Assurance Provision. They said, quote, "The point of the Farmer Assurance Provision is to strike a careful balance, allowing farmers to continue to plant and cultivate their crops subject to appropriate environmental safeguards, while USDA conducts any necessary further environmental reviews." But I want to go to the core of really what you're both concerned about, and that is the issue of genetically engineered foods. Greg Jaffe, you're not as concerned as Winona Howder. Talk about what genetically engineered foods are and what your thoughts are on them.
So, farmers have been growing genetically engineered crops for about 15 years now in the United States. And those varieties of corn and soybeans and cotton and canola were engineered in the laboratory by scientists, where they add a gene from a different organism that imparts a specific trait, a beneficial trait, into that crop. And then that crop is grown, and then food is made from that crop. So we have some crops that have a built-in pesticide, for example, so that we don't need to spray a chemical pesticide over the top of those crops. If that's a genetically engineered corn, that corn might end up in our food in terms of high fructose corn syrup or corn starch or corn flakes and something along those lines. The evidence to date on the current crops that are grown in the United States is that those are safe to eat. I think there is a strong international consensus about that. At CSPI, we're comfortable in telling people that if you're going to be eating food made from those crops that are currently out there, there is not a food safety risk associated with those crops. That's different than the regulatory system, and I think maybe that's at the core of some of this. And I think that whether we're talking about the USDA, the Department of Agriculture, or the Food and Drug Administration, or the Environmental Protection Agency, clearly the U.S. regulatory system and oversight of these crops has not been ideal. And so, at the center, we've been working for a number of years to try to improve that regulatory system, to give the agencies the authority to make sure, before these crops get out there, that they are safe to eat and they are safe for the environment. So while we can say they're safe current ones, for the future ones, we would like the agencies to take a little closer look at them.
Well, let's get a response from Winona Howder. Your thoughts on this issue, the argument here being that the science so far shows that it's safe, but regulation needs to improve.
Well, first of all, I would disagree that there's any international agreement that genetically engineered crops are safe. And in fact, they're banned in some countries. And there's a lot of concern in places like Europe, where we have the precautionary principle about genetically engineered foods. And there actually is a body of research that shows that genetically engineered soy and corn have health effects. These studies are feeding studies on animals, which is how this research is generally done. They show liver and kidney impairment. There are a number of studies showing this. Rat pups whose mothers ate genetically engineered soy had high mortality rates. And the genetically engineered hormone that's used to it's actually injected into cows so that they produce more milk. Italian research has found that those transgenes actually survive, they survive pasteurization and they end up in the milk. So part of the problem is also that there isn't enough research. We have a very lax regulatory system. The technology licensing agreements that Monsanto and other companies have for the biotech products that they develop mean that researchers can't legally get a hold of these seeds or grow the crops to actually do testing. And there's also not money for the kind of long-term health impact studies that there should be when you're doing such a major change in our food system. So I think there are a lot of reasons to be concerned. And we're also talking about the immense control over seeds that, one company—I mean, we basically have three companies that dominate seeds in the world. So if you're saying that there's no problem with genetically engineered seeds, you're very narrowly looking at what the impacts could be on the developing world. Even farmers here, where Monsanto regularly investigates 500 farmers approximately every year and sues them if they don't adhere to their contract. Monsanto is very aggressive with farmers, and it's very clear that this is simply a way to control seeds and profit from them and from their co-branded chemicals, the herbicides like Roundup Ready that are applied along with the genetically engineered crops that are sowed in the fields.
Your response, Greg Jaffe?
I'm not here to defend Monsanto or the industry. I would agree that they have practices that may not be the best practices out there. They're clearly out to make money. There's no question about that. But I think we have to separate the company from the merits of these individual crops themselves. And so when I talk about the safety of the crops, I'm talking about a case-by-case basis. I can't say that the future crops, whether a future crop is going to be safe or not going to be safe. We can only look at what we have today and look at the best scientific evidence out there and say, is this genetically engineered corn, this variety that's has a built-in pesticide, and is it safe to eat? Is it safe for the environment?
And do you adequately studied and that the corporate influence over the science hasn't prevented that or contaminated the results?
I think that, you know, the Food and Drug Administration, the European Food Safety Agency, the WHO, the World Health Organization, the Royal Academy of Sciences, the National Academy of Sciences, a lot of these international scientific bodies have taken a look as independent scientists at not just the information that Monsanto or the biotech developer has provided, but all of the research out there. And I think that, in fact, I think the European Food Safety Agency spent millions of dollars giving independent researchers to do risk assessment work around these genetically engineered crops. And to date, the consensus has been, again, for the current crops that are out there, that those crops are safe to eat and that they have some environmental benefits and that any environmental risks that they have can be mitigated, keeping in mind, obviously, that in the agriculture has a huge environmental footprint.
Do you feel the science is as established as as Greg Jaffe is saying, Winona Howder?
No, I don't think that the science is as established. And I think you have to look at the enormous power that these companies have on our regulatory agencies here and increasingly in Europe. We at Food and Water Watch have a Brussels office, and one of our main jobs there is trying to document the footprint that our U.S. biotech industry is having in Europe, trying to influence their food safety agency and the different governments that some of which have bans on genetically engineered food. I think that this is a political issue. This is not about the safety of these crops, because there really has never been long-term research on what the impact is, both on the diet and on the environment. And I'm concerned when I see that the immense amount of money that Monsanto and other companies are spending on trying to greenwash themselves, when they are able to persuade well-meaning advocates that they've done a good job. I mean, I think we have to look at Monsanto. They have spent, just over a two-year period, $279 million on advertising, talking about how they want to feed the world and that they're really doing this for the benefit of humankind, not to make money. But when you look at what they're actually doing, they are making an enormous profit on seeds. Seeds are becoming increasingly expensive. And there are a lot of broader issues besides the few health impact and environment studies that have been done. I mean, we have to look at this in the broadest context of what it means to give one, two, three companies this much control over how seeds are sold and produced and food is produced.
Well, let's talk about the movement to label products containing the ingredients made by these companies. While on the campaign trail in 2007, presidential candidate Barack Obama promised to label GMO foods if elected.
Here's what I'll do as president. I'll immediately implement country of origin labeling because Americans should know where their food comes from. We'll let folks know whether their food has been genetically modified because Americans should know what they're buying.
That's President Obama speaking in 2007 before he was elected president. Greg Jaffe, do you support the labeling of GMO foods?
We support the fact that consumers should have the right to know and should be able to get information about their foods, whether their foods are genetically engineered, whether their foods came from plants that were irradiated or were produced through chemical mutagenesis. So we do think consumers who want to know about how their foods were produced and where they came from should have a right to do that. We aren't supportive of a mandatory label, putting on mandatory label at this point on whether a food was genetically engineered or not. And that is in part because we don't want information out there that's misleading to the consumer, and also because we want to ensure that the most important information, mandatory labeling is left for the most important information, so information that it directly impacts food safety or the health of consumers or nutrition of consumers. Keeping in mind, again, that the current genetically engineered crops, the way that most consumers eat those foods is in highly processed ingredients. So we eat corn as high fructose corn syrup or corn oil. And when we produce high fructose corn syrup or corn oil or sugar from sugar, genetically engineered sugar beets, we eliminate all of the genetically engineered elements. We eliminate the DNA, we eliminate the protein that was produced by that DNA that had been engineered into the plant. And so biologically and chemically, whether you have two jars of corn oil, one from genetically engineered crops and one from non-genetically engineered crops side by side, they are biologically and chemically identical. And so
let's get Winona Howder's response to this issue of food labeling. Winona.
Well, consumers want and should have the right to know if their food is genetically engineered. And while many of the crops that have been genetically engineered do go into processed food, today we're seeing the foods that end up on your plate being either already genetically engineered or in the pipeline for approval. I'm talking about the GE sweet corn that was approved last year. There's been a multi-year battle over GE salmon. And while we hope the FDA does not approve it, and there has been a huge outpouring of support for not approving it, we're concerned that if they move ahead, it will not be labeled. One of the health effects that we do know happens from eating genetically engineered products is an allergy to protein. So for the genetically engineered salmon, there could be very serious allergic reactions that could occur, and the food should be labeled. And people believe that they have a right to know what's in their food. So I think that voluntary labeling is not enough. And in fact, what's exciting is there is a backlash against the biotech industry. There are campaigns in more than 30 states fighting to get labeling for genetically engineered food. So even though the biotech industry has spent a boatload of money to stop it, there is a movement growing, and I believe that we will see genetically engineered food labeled.
Winona Howder, I know Greg Jaffe has to leave, and I want him to weigh in on genetically engineered salmon. Greg.
So first, I might make a statement that I think, you know, the most important thing, if there's any question about whether a food is an allergen or a potential allergen because it was genetically engineered, our view is that that should not be allowed on the market. We shouldn't use labeling as a surrogate for safety. We shouldn't allow a food that is an allergen, that has a new allergen, onto the food supply and label it and let people choose. If there's any food safety risk from that food, it shouldn't be allowed, which is why we at CSPI advocate for a mandatory pre-market approval process of these genetically engineered crops and animals beforehand, because if there's any question of safety, they shouldn't go on the market. We don't believe we should allow them on the market, but because they're an allergen, label them and let people choose. So I just wanted to clarify that. The genetically engineered salmon, I think that I think there's been a lot of misunderstanding out there about this genetically engineered salmon that's in front of FDA for approval. In my mind, it's really just a proof of concept application. The company has requested that this salmon be grown in one facility in Panama for inland tanks and is only going to produce a small amount of this salmon. Less than 1% of the salmon that we would import would be this genetically engineered salmon. So although I'm still waiting to see whether FDA does approve that and whether it's safe to eat and safe for the environment, assuming that they do that, I think that it's going to be a long time before we might see this as a dominant part of the salmon market.
We're going to break, and then we're going to continue with Winona Howder on her new book, Foodopoly. Greg Jaffe, I want to thank you so much for being with us, director of the Biotechnology Project at the Center for Science and the Public Interest, and also Winona Howder with Food and Water Watch. We'll come back with Winona in a minute.
Thank you very much.
Thanks so much for watching this report from Democracy Now!, your daily independent global news hour. We don't accept advertising or corporate funding, but rather rely on donations from viewers like you. Please make your contribution by visiting democracynow.org. We need your support today to keep bringing you this hard-hitting, in-depth reporting.